So first off, I wanted to show you a map of where people were coming from and what types of people were coming to different areas. And so if you look at these states here, most people coming into these northeastern states were coming from European countries. But then if you begin to look at Texas, and this copy of your map is in your book as well, if you begin to look at Texas and California, then you'll notice that most of these immigrants are coming from either Mexico or even, in the case of California, from China or Japan. But millions of immigrants have come in. In fact, most of us can trace back our descent to immigrants. And most are coming here to seek better lives. Some are coming here on a temporary basis to work with temporary work visas and then going back to their home countries. But we're going to first talk about Europe, because at this time particularly, you know, late 1800s, early 1900s, about 20 million Europeans had arrived. Most were coming to find a better life, and many were coming to flee religious persecution. In fact, there were a large number of Jewish immigrants and a large number of Catholic immigrants coming from Ireland, Jewish mainly from Eastern Europe. Jews had been driven from Russia by pogroms. This was a strategy used by the Tsar at the time to attempt to unify Russia by requiring that all Russians practice Eastern Orthodox Christianity. They were even required to shave their beards, and they were required to follow Russian culture. And the Jews refused to do so, and they were persecuted, and so they came over to the United States to flee. This population growth is quite significant. 20 million people coming in a 50-year period. That's a huge influx to our population. So this does result in a lack of available farmland on the East Coast, big competition for jobs, and it's going to create some interesting issues. For one, young people will be coming in primarily. In fact, it's primarily young people moving to the country at this time. And so, again, it's going to create an enormous amount of job pressure, which will lead to an enormous amount of racial tension. But it's also an exciting possibility. I would be willing to bet that many of our ancestors came over during this time. For example, my grandpa's dad came over from France around this time, moved to Brooklyn, like so many other European immigrants, came to the New York area because that's where the main processing station was for immigrants, and that's also, being such a large city, where so many of the jobs were. And so my accent does split between Northern and Deep South because of that reason, because of my mom's family that came to the New York area. So, the Golden Door, as it was called, was the opportunity to come into the United States. It was seen as this open door where immigrants could come in, and they did by the millions from all over the world. In fact, 20 million Europeans were coming in. Around 300,000 Chinese immigrants came in at this time. Many attracted by the gold rush. Many wound up working on the railroads, farms, mines, and domestic service, even in private businesses. Many Japanese immigrants were coming in at this time as well. Many had come in to work on Hawaiian plantations to save up passage to get to California. In fact, Hawaii is roughly halfway between Asia and the United States. By 1920, more than 200,000 Japanese Americans had arrived on the West Coast as well. Now, people were coming from all over the world, as I said. In fact, even about 260,000 immigrants had come in from the West Indies many seeking jobs in industry. But of these groups coming into the western part of the United States, the largest by far were Mexican Americans. Roughly 700,000 Mexican Americans had arrived in the United States by 1910. Many were fleeing the political turmoil that was going on there around the time. In fact, when we get to chapter 18, we'll be talking about a lot of the political troubles that Mexico was experiencing around this same time. For example, after Antonio López de Santa Anna was ousted, he was replaced by a military governor, who was then replaced by a popular revolutionary, who was then replaced by another far right-wing fascist type. So Mexico was going through some political troubles. And even by the early 1900s, it was becoming an unsafe place to live, unsafe to the point that many wanted to flee. The National Reclamation Act created large expanses of farmland out of the Great Plains and out of the Southwest, large opportunities for farmers to come in and make a living for themselves. So let's talk about the journey to get there. Most immigrants arrived by steamship. Steamships had become a very popular and cost-effective way to travel. Extremely large steam engines, meaning a very, very hot coal furnace containing steam under enormous amounts of pressure, capable of moving these large vessels. And so they could sometimes be dangerous. Explosions could happen aboard one of these vessels. Most would have to arrive in steerage. I don't know if you're a fan of the movie Titanic, but that follows another common immigrant story, how DiCaprio played a very poor immigrant coming to the United States who had to travel in steerage. It's the very, very bottom of the ship. Often immigrants would have to find work on these ships to be able to afford their passage overseas. In fact, my wife and I went on a cruise, not this year, but last year, and we're going to go on one next year as well. They're nice. The cheap seats, though, are called steerage. You ride in the bottom of the boat. If you want to ride in a nicer class, then certainly you have to pay the price. Now, most of these immigrants from Europe are arriving at Ellis Island. It's still a popular tourist destination, although the immigration station there has closed. I'll show you a photograph of it in just a moment. But it is the chief U.S. immigration station in New York Harbor. Immigrants there would be inspected by doctors. If you contained a serious illness, highly contagious, then you would not be admitted into the United States. Inspectors would check documents to see if immigrants meet the legal requirements to come into the United States. If you have outstanding warrants for your arrest, we are an extradition country, meaning that we will turn you over to the country you committed crimes in. If you are considered a danger to yourself or others, whether through mental illness or a past history of affiliation with dangerous organizations, you will not be admitted, etc. But in the late 1800s and early 1900s, about 17 million immigrants were processed through. And so here's a photograph of immigrants coming off of the boat, and here's a photograph of Ellis Island as it looks today. Though now it's just a tourist attraction, you can go there and you can visit, buy a ticket, and see what the immigrant experience was like at that time. New York is still one of our main immigration ports. And so next let's talk about immigrants arriving on the West Coast. And you see here a photograph of Asian immigrants who were arriving and waiting to be processed at Angel Island. Angel Island in San Francisco is the main immigrant processing station on the West Coast. And so the same process here. Immigrants would endure harsh questioning, long detention before being admitted into the United States. But next, I want you to imagine yourself as new to an area. You've now moved all the way across the country, or even perhaps to another country. What are you going to do? What's the first thing you need? So let's just pause and think about that for a second. What's one of the first things that you would need as a new immigrant coming? Well, this is just, that's human nature. You're going to seek help from people who have had the same experience. They are less likely to judge you. They are more likely to be sympathetic to what you have gone through. And immigrants have the necessity of creating a whole new life, of, like you said, finding work, finding shelter. And you're going to seek out people who share a common culture. Perhaps you don't speak the language of the place where you are going. Well, the first thing you need to find are people who speak your language. If you've ever moved from another country, or if you've ever lived in another country, that's an immediate need, almost as much so as shelter. You're also going to seek people who share common cultural values, because no one wants to be judged. So you're going to seek people who can identify with where you're coming from. But this also creates friction between people who have come here from somewhere else and people who were born here. That idea of nativism. And it is sad and unfortunate that this culture of nativism has not gone away, that we've seen so much of that same type of attitude, even in this election. This is the attitude I'm talking about. Native-born Americans looking down on immigrants. And this cartoon, again drawn by Thomas Nast, points out some of the classic illogical reasons that native-born Americans have in feeling this way. You know, here you see Uncle Sam holding his nose in disgust at an immigrant. But the great irony here is if ever you go to the Statue of Liberty, and I have not actually got to go myself. I've been to New York, but I didn't go to the Statue of Liberty. I wish I had, though. There's a statue engraved at the foot of the Statue of Liberty. Does anybody know what that statue says?
Welcome.
Essentially, welcome. Yeah, there's a big welcome mat on our country. Though we don't always act that way, right? The statue says, and I quote, "Give me your tired, poor, hungry masses yearning to be free." It says, come on, come on, come on, come everybody. Welcome. And yet this is how we often view immigrants. Let me read some of these things for you. Sabbath desecration. That is in regard to different religions that immigrants bring. It's good we don't feel that way anymore, right? Wink, wink. Anarchy. Different political ideas that people bring with them. Poverty. Disease. It is unfortunate that sometimes people have these attitudes towards immigrants. And this is a culture called nativism. Because like it or not, we are a cosmopolitan country. That means we are a country of many cultures and many ideas. I had a neat discussion with a sociology professor the other day. And he and I both agreed that multiculturalism, known as pluralism, is essential for democracy. You see, democracy means a rule by the people. Well, the people aren't naturally going to feel the same way about everything. Uniformity is fascism. Multiculturalism is democracy. But if we are truly going to be democratic, that means we truly have to accept people with different values. But that can be difficult to do. Because perhaps the way you live or the beliefs you have, perhaps you feel those are the beliefs to have or the way to live. And if you are raised and you have grown up around people that only believe those things, and they share only those ideas that you share, it can be mind-blowing to go outside of your culture. And that was my experience. I grew up in an extremely rural area. There wasn't a stoplight within 30 miles of my house. Everyone within my community had the same skin color, and generally the same religion, and generally the same political beliefs. And of course, that's how I was raised, so that's how I grew up. And that's what I thought. Until I went off to live in a community with people who believed entirely different than myself, and people who had grown up entirely different. And it really wasn't until the summer after my first year of college, where I went to work in Panama City, and I began working with people from all over the world, spending all day with them working in a little restaurant where a lot of international business students were also getting jobs. At this water park, I worked at a restaurant, and it blew my mind. It was really an eye-opening experience for me. Now, I can sit here and tell you about that, but until you have some kind of experience like that, it can be really difficult to open your eyes to think about other cultures. So it's something I would encourage you to do. In fact, in the spring, around spring break, I'm going to encourage you and give you a cultural experience assignment. And I want you to think about it between now and then. There's not a lot of details to the assignment. It's effectively to go out and do something amazing. To go out and interact with people that you've never seen before, and to have some kind of experience that's outside of your cultural comfort zone. And then to tell us about it. And then you'll come back after spring break, and I want to hear what you did. You can do that at any time. Anytime, if you have some neat experience like that, please raise your hand, stop class, we'll stop wherever we are, and I want to hear about it. Because that's social studies. That's going outside and really learning and having that experience. Because you see, when you associate yourself only with like-minded people, then you begin to develop this feeling that your way is the way. For example, many nativists, of course, were white, were Protestant, and were native born, obviously. And many felt their way was superior to other people's. Many objected to other religions that immigrants brought with them. And many pressured Congress to pass laws restricting the rights of immigrants, such as a literacy bill for immigrants requiring that immigrants prove they can read and write in English prior to achieving citizenship. Nativism found a foothold in the labor movement. It is sad that when you take a people who are downtrodden and you give them a common enemy, that can make people blind to their own plight. One of my favorite folk songs in regards to this subject is Bob Dylan's Only a Pawn in Their Game. And one of the lines in the song says, when you teach a man that he is better than them because of the color of his skin, it makes him ignore the shape that he is in. That he is in the caboose on the train. That he is only a pawn in their game. It is unfortunate that people as downtrodden as the American worker would find a common enemy in the immigrants. Because unfortunately, when you come to a place as a new person, you find yourself having to work for less than what others might. And that's because your situation is desperate. You know, perhaps your citizenship is questionable. Perhaps your immigration status is questionable. And because of these things, the only opportunities that may be available to you are less than savory and don't pay terribly well. And that has been the common immigrant experience in our country's history. It is going on now, and sadly has been going on throughout our country's history. Whereas today it is many Hispanic immigrants,
At this time on the West Coast, it was Chinese immigrants who would be forced to work for less, and labor groups would exert political pressure to restrict immigration. Just as many poor today are using, and many poor are being used to consider immigrants a scapegoat to the plight that they're in. In fact, Congress was pressured in 1882 to pass the Chinese Exclusion Act, which banned entry to Chinese immigrants altogether. Nativists feared an extension to the Japanese immigrants and most Asians in general in the early 1900s. For example, San Francisco had segregated schools. Japanese school children were forced to go to their own schools and not allowed to integrate with white Americans there. The country of Japan agreed to limit immigration, and in return, the United States would grant greater rights for Japanese immigrants living there. The sad part here is that the Chinese Exclusion Act built a wall, not a literal wall, but a wall nonetheless barring entry of Chinese immigrants. In fact, there were many cases of riots against immigrants, violent acts against immigrants. I wanted to start with a picture of a city. In fact, this is today the second largest city on the planet. Does anybody know what city this is?
LA
is in the top 10, but it's not the second biggest. Certainly not the biggest. Anybody? Not Chicago. Not New York. What do you think?
Here in America.
Maybe it's a surprise to you. This is Mexico City, in fact. The second largest city in the world. The largest city in the world is Cairo. But yeah, that's Mexico City. So, industrialization, that is mass consumption of products made in factories rather than at home, leads to urbanization because industries tend to pay better than your average job, certainly better than farms, and people flock to these jobs because of a chance for a better life. And most of these industries locate near cities for several reasons. Number one, a reliable market base. There's lots of people there to buy their products. Number two, reliable transportation infrastructure. Cities tend to be located near water or near major railways, near thoroughfares where they can move their product. And then finally, industries like to locate near sources of cheap labor, which are going to be large population centers. Many immigrants are moving into cities for a number of reasons as well, because that's where the jobs are, that's where they can find cheap housing, and that's also where their best chances of meeting other immigrants of common ethnicities are going to be. You know, if I'm an Asian American, I can move to a larger city in the Northeast, and I can find a large community of other Asian Americans. Well, there was a large movement going on in the latter half of the 1800s. It was called the Americanization Movement. It was a movement to assimilate people into the main culture, meaning that when you come here from another place, of course we talked about those immediate concerns of finding a job, shelter, food, safety, comfort, etc. But there's also the long-term concerns of learning the language, of becoming a citizen, of incorporating yourself into the culture that you have moved into. And so schools began ESL programs. Voluntary groups, churches, community centers began to teach citizenship skills, English language, American history, how to cook American dishes even, and also, you know, certain quirks of American culture. Etiquette, for example. And ethnic communities of other immigrants are the primary support base for many people moving into this country. Now, as farm technology increased, farms no longer needed massive labor forces. Cotton can be harvested mechanically. Corn can be harvested with a giant tractor. And no longer do you need these huge labor forces on plantations. And so many people's jobs were replaced by machines. And they began to move to cities because that's where the jobs were at that time. Many African Americans in the South were these laborers affected by mechanization. And many of them began to move to the North, and particularly to move to cities. And while discrimination in the South is legendary, discrimination in the North existed as well. And often it was in the form of job competition, because many people resented new people moving into the area who provided a cheap source of labor. And so this created tension. In fact, many of the labor movements that we talked about a few days ago refused entry for African Americans or immigrants in some cases. But let's talk about some basic concerns for rapidly growing cities. One of these is transportation. Many people who live in large cities today don't even bother to purchase a car. I know that's something you're looking forward to, and in a rural area, it's a very practical thing to own your own car. Yet in a large city, it may not be practical because there is not space to put your car. Traffic is a nightmare in some large cities. And so mass transit is how many people get around in large cities. Mass transit means my aunt every day in Chicago rides an L to work. It's an elevated train. It's kind of cool. I've ridden it with her before when I was a kid and went up to visit. She rides that every day to work. And then from there, she gets onto a bus that finally takes her to her destination. She doesn't even drive to work. Now, she lives outside the city. They do own a car to get to soccer matches and things. But otherwise, she relies on mass transit. But of course, if we're talking about the late 1800s, mass transit in a city, well, it's rather limited, right? Horsepower. But next, housing. Where are people going to live? A very practical concern. Working class families wind up living in houses on the outskirts of cities, or often even in boarding houses, living in temporary dwellings. Immigrants would often have to double up. Anybody who didn't have a great job would often have to put two or three families in a home together to split bills. And these are often called tenements. The textbook definition is multi-family urban dwelling. And this can be tricky. I don't know if you've ever had, maybe you have a really large family and you're used to that already. I had roommates in college. I've even shared a room with up to 8 people for summer trips. It can be challenging, and you have to get used to no privacy. 8 people in one restroom, well, that does require just a bit of sacrifice and patience. It can also be just plain old unsanitary. One person in that room gets sick, everybody gets sick because we all share the same germs. But of course, like I was talking about, mass transit. Mass transit provides the ability for large groups of people to move quickly through a city along fixed routes. If you go on our DC trip next year, you'll get to see the subway. If you have time, you can ride on it perhaps. And while subways were a relatively new phenomenon, and not many cities had them by the early 1900s, there were forms of transit connecting people with suburbs. And I'll show you a few early examples in just a moment. Because when you have large numbers of horses in a city, that creates some real concerns. For example, horses obviously poop. Nothing you can do about that. And if you're in a large city, well, street sweeping is not exactly a glamorous job, but somebody has to clean up the poop. Well, if you have a large growing city and more people bringing in horses, well, that's more and more poop. In a poorer place, without the tax base to pay for more street sweepers, you get piles of poop. It got so bad in Memphis, Tennessee, in fact, there was an outbreak of cholera, I believe, associated with mosquitoes that would breed in the poop. So bad, they had to burn parts of the city to the ground and rebuild. But this photograph is what's called a dumbbell tenement. It's looking down on it from the roof. A dumbbell tenement means that you have a high-rise, well, for that time, a high-rise apartment building with many, many different families living on different floors. In between these two buildings, you have an alleyway. And another one of the main concerns of a large growing city is sanitation. Because you see, with no running water, for many people that served as where you dump out the bucket, if you get my drift, it's also where you dump much of your trash. People just throw things into the alley, and it's rather disgusting. But next, housing. Where are people going to live? A very practical concern. Working class families wind up living in houses on the outskirts of cities, or often even in boarding houses, living in temporary dwellings. Immigrants would often have to double up. Anybody who didn't have a great job would often have to put two or three families in a home together to split bills. And these are often called tenements. The textbook definition is multi-family urban dwelling. And this can be tricky. I don't know if you've ever had, maybe you have a really large family and you're used to that already. I had roommates in college. I've even shared a room with up to 8 people for summer trips. It can be challenging, and you have to get used to no privacy. 8 people in one restroom, well, that does require just a bit of sacrifice and patience. It can also be just plain old unsanitary. One person in that room gets sick, everybody gets sick because we all share the same germs. But of course, like I was talking about, mass transit. Mass transit provides the ability for large groups of people to move quickly through a city along fixed routes. If you go on our DC trip next year, you'll get to see the subway. If you have time, you can ride on it perhaps. And while subways were a relatively new phenomenon, and not many cities had them by the early 1900s, there were forms of transit connecting people with suburbs. I'll show you a few early examples in just a moment. Because when you have large numbers of horses in a city, that creates some real concerns. For example, horses obviously poop. Nothing you can do about that. And if you're in a large city, well, street sweeping is not exactly a glamorous job, but somebody has to clean up the poop. Well, if you have a large growing city and more people bringing in horses, well, that's more and more poop. In a poorer place, without the tax base to pay for more street sweepers, you get piles of poop. It got so bad in Memphis, Tennessee, in fact, there was an outbreak of cholera, I believe, associated with mosquitoes that would breed in the poop. So bad, they had to burn parts of the city to the ground and rebuild. You see, in the 1860s, many cities have inadequate, or in some cases, no running water. Certainly not in their buildings. Indoor plumbing was a very exclusive luxury. And yet again, it's something we take for granted. Often in large cities in the late 1800s, you would have to boil the water before you drank it. filtration wasn't actually introduced at all in cities until 1870. And so without an understanding of bacteriology, people just got sick a lot because they were drinking nasty water. Chlorination. Chlorine is capable of killing many of the really nasty bugs. Wasn't actually introduced in cities until 1908. Again, I got to get gross for a minute with sanitation. The next picture I'm going to show you is rather disturbing. With streets, of course, with horse transportation, you have large piles of manure laying around. Open gutters are essentially ditches on the sides of streets where the water can run off into sewer systems, but without complex sewer systems, these would often back up, creating huge puddles of really disgusting tepid water. Factories weren't exactly environmentally friendly back then. Most were powered by steam, and that means you're burning large amounts of coal, which puts off tons and tons of smoke. And so cities had a horrible smell to them. I mean, if you lived in a city, you're going to develop respiratory problems from constantly inhaling smoke. Now, contractors could find work sweeping streets, collecting garbage, or cleaning outhouses. It's honest work. It's how I started. It was my first job, was cleaning garbage. And it's tough work. It is. It's nasty work. Honest work, but with large cities like this, you're talking about a massive undertaking. And really, no cities had sewer lines, that is underground sewage, until 1900. What are we looking at here? Well, so there's some kids playing. As Jade said, by a dead horse. What are they playing in, by the way? That's an open sewer. So it's basically a gutter where rainwater and waste can run off into this gutter and ideally get out of the city eventually. Are the kids wearing shoes?
Nope.
Yeah, thought I'd point that out. There's standing water, who knows what's mixed with it. Generally, it's a pretty poor situation. But next, let's talk about crime. See, as populations grew, thieves were able to flourish because early police forces were ineffective. In fact, the original Sherlock Holmes was written in London around this time. And with a lack of forensic evidence, with the quality of detective work rather primitive at that time, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, the author of Sherlock, based his novel around the principles of deduction, of figuring out using context to solve crimes. But I want to tell you the story about a man named Dr. Daniel Holmes. It's a true story of a doctor who was practicing in Chicago as the city was preparing for its great World's Fair in 1900. And the whole city was preparing to host the greatest exhibition on the planet. Cities competed just like they do for the Olympics every 10 years. The World's Fair would be held. The previous in 1890 was held in Paris. And by the way, the Eiffel Tower was built in Paris for the World's Fair. That's how big a deal this thing is. And so Chicago's got to beat the Eiffel Tower. Well, how do we beat the Eiffel Tower? That's known around the world, international symbol of France. How do we beat the Eiffel Tower? Well, the challenge was to build something that had never been done before. And so the Ferris wheel was built for the Great White City, which is where the World's Fair was hosted. Well, at the same time as the construction of this amazing Ferris wheel, and the Buffalo Bill Wild West show was there, and the city threw out all the stops just like they do for the Olympics. There was a doctor who was practicing. He was a very good-looking man. He always hired young women to be his assistants. And he would always take out life insurance policies on them. It was just one of the conditions of the job. But, Chase, after a while, these young women would disappear. But, no worries. He would always hire women that were unattached. And he would always just claim, well, they moved back with their families. They went back to the countryside in Illinois, whatever, you know. It happens, it's life. And no one ever really followed up. Because who's going to challenge the word of this young, attractive doctor? Well, eventually, an insurance claims adjuster did just that. Because this man had the audacity to cash in on these young women. He was cashing in on these policies and collecting on life insurance policies when he claimed they would get sick and pass or whatever. And eventually this insurance claims adjuster began to do some research. And it was tough to get a warrant because there was really no proof. I mean, he was in good reputation and good standing. But as he continued to dig, he found there was a basement with no clear door. But there was this basement. And occasionally he would see smoke coming out of it. Well, finally he was able to get a warrant. And finally, after several attempts, they were able to discover this basement. There was an autopsy table, and there was a crematorium. You see, he was actually performing experiments on these young women, dissecting them, labeling their anatomy, and publishing his work in medical journals. Because at that time, there was no reliable way to get cadavers to study. And so med students were commonly known to dig up freshly buried corpses. Well, this man had a reliable source of the freshest corpses. And again, he was publishing his work. His work is still, you can find it in American journals. Well, he was brought to trial, hearing the nickname Dr. Death. This is a really creepy case. In fact, the story of this is published. It's a really famous novel called Devil in the White City. And it's a fact, you got to read it. It's really good. And yeah, it's really good, I promise. Now, when he was brought to trial, this man was completely without remorse. In fact, he said, "I've advanced the cause of science, and I have nothing to be ashamed of for what I've done. My work will save lives." And really, who's to miss these young women anyway? I mean, it's just creepy stuff. Well, anyway, the point is, he was able to get away with this for over a decade. Because as cities were growing so rapidly, you know, there was no great system for keeping up with who was coming in, who was coming out. Oh, you know. And of course, fire hazards. There's also the Great Fire of Chicago. The city once caught on fire, and almost the entire city burned to the ground at one point because many of the building materials, brick and mortar, wood, weren't exactly fire resistant. Many of the sources of heat involved open flame. Fire departments were usually volunteer based and often poorly equipped. Yet by 1900, most cities do have full-time professional fire departments. Non-flammable building materials do make buildings much safer. I mean, if, you know, the worst happened, we had a horrible fire in this room, most of the materials this room is made out of are flame retardant. I mean, the posters would burn. I mean, our clothing could certainly catch on fire. The stuff around the room could burn. But the building itself, well, that would be okay. So, since cities were often incapable of fixing many of these problems for themselves, many individuals and organizations and private charities stepped in to try to help to relieve urban poverty. For example, the Social Gospel Movement was a nationwide cultural movement which preached that salvation was more than personal edification, but was intended to make people want to help others. There were a number of community centers in poor neighborhoods. These were often called settlement houses. They were often run by college-educated women who would provide educational, cultural, and social services. Of course, there are a number of these today. Our county has a homeless shelter. Our county has a place for abused women to seek refuge and to help them with relocating. These settlement houses, even in the early 1900s, would send visiting nurses to make house calls to sick or shut-in people. And they would also help with personal job and financial programs. In fact, much of our community college exists for that purpose as well. One of the early famous reformers here was Jane Addams, who founded the Hull House with Ellen Gates. And here she is with her students. So anyway, there's Jane Addams, and this is one of the earliest settlement houses. First off, after the Civil War, many states began to pass laws requiring schools to provide services for all children, but also requiring children to attend schools. Now, previously, this only meant elementary school. In fact, really until the mid-20th century, for most people, that only meant elementary school. Kindergarten was a German concept around the development of children to prepare them for elementary school. It became very popular. But around the 1880s, here's what we have. Most children attending school were white. In fact, about 62% of children attending elementary school were white. Really only about one out of every three African-American children were able to attend school, and these were segregated schools. High school, meanwhile, of course what we're involved in, was still considered a luxury, and public high schools were still very rare. Usually they were called preparatory schools because they were designed to prepare young people for entrance into college. And they were designed primarily around academics, exclusively focused on college prep. And so you would take classes like history, math, literature, again, classes focused on helping you acquire those academic skills. However, by 1900, while only 500,000 students nationwide were attending high schools, our industrial economy began to demand students with not only academic skills, but also technical or managerial skills. Skills that may not require a college education, but would require some type of post-elementary instruction. And high schools began to expand in what they offered to accommodate for the needs of industry. And so we began to see technical schools arise, community colleges arise, but also career and technical education opportunities within high schools. For example, the new school that we're hoping to see next year will offer you the opportunity to take classes that you don't previously have available to you. So if you're wanting to acquire skills in mechatronics, shop, construction, cosmetology, a lot of practical hands-on certification programs, those will become available to you, and those do fit a need within our community. Now, I mentioned race earlier. In high schools, even, a very small percentage of black teenagers were able to attend high school. There were some schools post-elementary for African Americans. Perhaps the most famous of these was the Tuskegee Normal and Industrial Institute in Alabama, founded by Booker T. Washington, that we're studying over the next couple of weeks. Most African American students attended private schools that had no public support. These would either be funded from within their community, or they would have to pay tuition. For example, the Tuskegee Normal and Industrial Institute was a private university funded through grants and endowments from the black community, but it was not tax supported, not for a very long time. Immigrants, meanwhile, immigrants were encouraged to attend school as part of the process of becoming Americanized, as part of the process of acquiring the English language and learning about American culture. You know, immigrant communities do typically hang on to aspects of their native cultures. You know, many first-generation immigrants continue to speak their native language and teach their children their native language along with the English language. It's why so many of you are dual speakers, because you have learned your native heritage and language from your families, but you've also learned the English language from attending school and just your local interactions. At this time, it was commonplace for public schools to have readings from the Protestant Bible, though Catholics attended their own Catholic schools, which would have readings from the Bible as well as readings from church teachings. Adults had opportunities to attend night school. Again, there were community colleges. There were some day programs for education for adults. But again, community college was kind of a new phenomenon at this time. University. Very few people had the opportunity to attend university at this time. In fact, maybe as few as 2% of young people had attended college. And so what we've seen as we've progressed as a society is that more people have had that opportunity. In fact, even through the early 1900s, college enrollment quadrupled. Universities have grown in the programs they offer and the services they offer, the curricula that they can offer. Universities have also grown to become centers of research. You know, Duke University, one of the research universities in North Carolina, is still leading the fields in many different sciences. Professional law schools and medical schools have become established in the United States, and many of these universities are very exclusive, especially at this time, in terms of having entrance exams. Some would require a high school diploma, yet high schools were very rare at this time, and so many would just have very competitive entrance exams. And so you could prepare for those exams by having your family hire a private tutor, or by sending your children to these preparatory schools, which have evolved into high schools. But again, most high schools at this time were privately funded, and so the opportunity that you have just didn't exist at this time. But now a little about Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois. The question that you are thinking about in your essay and learning about in your research is, how can racism be addressed in a society? How can we overcome racism? Booker T. Washington believed that education was one of the greatest ways to overcome racism in a society. And he realized that not enough black college graduates were getting degrees, that not enough young black Americans were getting educations. Washington believed that racism would eventually end as the black community became more educated and more equipped to enter the workforce and become leaders in their society. And he followed through on this vision by founding the Tuskegee Normal and Industrial Institute. It's now a university, primarily African American. And it was founded originally as a teaching college. Normal Institute means teaching college. But it also had industrial-based curricula to teach people to be managers and leaders in their fields. It was designed to help African Americans acquire useful job skills and become leaders in their community, because Washington believed that was the best way to overcome racism. Now, W.E.B. Du Bois had a different vision, however. Now, Du Bois also believed in education very strongly. In fact, he was the very first African American to receive a doctorate degree from Harvard University, a very exclusive university with a very competitive entrance exam. Not that many people got into this university. And so Du Bois made history by being the first black person to not only attend Harvard, but receive a doctorate from there. He founded a movement called the Niagara Movement to encourage African Americans to study the liberal arts. He also believed that well-educated leaders would be needed in the black community. But where the two differed, Washington believed, essentially, that blacks should keep their heads down and should smile and accept racism as a reality, but seek to earn the approval of the white man. Du Bois strongly disagreed, though he had a respect for Washington. Du Bois believed that blacks deserved the respect of citizens, and that racism was an affront on the equality that had been promised. And Du Bois believed that blacks needed to protest and perhaps even disobey laws peacefully to challenge racism, because he believed racism was shameful and that it could be overcome by forcing whites to confront the reality of their own hatred. And so Du Bois went on to found the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. In 1908, he founded the NAACP. So again, what you are thinking about in your essay is how to overcome racism. We all agree that's a problem. We can all understand that racism is still a problem. Washington's idea was that people should keep their head down, should not stand up for themselves, but should slowly earn the approval of a racist world. And so his goal was realized in the founding of a school. Du Bois, however, again, had this vision for overcoming racism. And really, it's become the movement that is the NAACP, that we should fight peacefully, and that we should protest, and that we should break laws peacefully to overcome racism. And so again, as you're doing your research and you're thinking about this, it is a very important question, because we all realize how troublesome racism is in our nation. And the election, sadly, has highlighted so much of this hatred. Yet, how do we overcome it? These are two fundamental ideas. Which would you choose? And that's what your essay is about. So, we talked about city parks, Central Park being the most famous. And so as cities were setting aside green space, such as parks, for recreation, many cities were also building amusement parks. They would often be built on the outskirts of cities. Of course, you've hopefully been to several, maybe Carowinds, maybe Dollywood. Six Flags was a big favorite for me as a kid. And these amusement parks would feature rides. In fact, the very first roller coaster in our country was in New York, in Coney Island. The very first Ferris wheel ever built was in Chicago for the Great World's Fair. And while these Ferris wheels and roller coasters were made of wooden frames, and so they were limited in what they can do. I mean, we're not hanging by our shoulders doing loops on the Superman ride yet, but we'll get there, right? And the neat thing that we can talk about in this section is what people did for fun. For example, bicycling. Early bicycles were not terribly practical. In fact, they were rather dangerous. The wheels would be made of wood often, and the wheels in some cases were built in a very impractical way, some as tall as a person's head. And you would need a stepladder to climb up onto the front wheel, which was very, very tall with a very short rear wheel. I never got that design. But anyway, bicycles allowed a mobility that people had not previously been able to access before, particularly for women. Women were able to move around more and access things outside the home that they had not been able to do. The safety bicycle was a game changer. The safety bicycle looked more like the modern bicycle, front and rear wheels of similar height, but most importantly, rubber wheels. That vulcanized rubber of Goodyear tires made that possible. Tennis was also a popular pastime. It was originally a British sport, and it's become very popular in the United States. Your book has this really weird picture of a multi-bicycle. I don't know why they decided to feature that, but again, you know.
It's because they're dressed like a rainbow.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't get it.
I guess, you know, the pop culture lessons aren't meant to be terribly serious. But anyway, some people just decided to take it to the next level. Okay. Yep. Spectator sports. You know, I love bicycling. I mean, I ride my bike, you know, probably 5 days a week. But it's not for everybody. You know, I like tennis. I enjoy it. But again, it's not for everybody. Some people prefer to watch sports. You know, of course, baseball is one of the oldest American pastimes, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. But even older than baseball is boxing. Now, boxing has been around for, well, I mean, since people decided that you could shape your hand into a fist. But the sport of boxing is also an ancient contest. And it's been popular throughout American history. One of the earliest boxing legends was John Sullivan. And with the advent of the radio, many Americans would tune in to listen to boxing matches. Boxing, as well as baseball, became very profitable businesses. Because if the standard of living is going up, which it was at that time, that means more Americans have more money. Now, also, as workers' lives were getting better, you know, the 8-hour workday was something that people were slowly winning the right to. As technology was increasing, we'll talk about that later, we have many labor-saving devices. Bottom line, people are experiencing more leisure time and more flexible income. And what are they going to do with that? Well, they're going to be able to have fun. And they're going to be able to, well, in the 30s, go to the movies. In the early 1900s, listen to the radio. In, you know, the late 1800s, even going to sporting matches, reading the newspaper. But of course, we have to talk about baseball. The first baseball club was organized in 1845 by a man named Alexander Cartwright. Set down the very first rules for baseball. Now, from 1845 forward, the sport has evolved greatly. We The first leagues formed. By 1876, there was the National League, and then a few years later, the American League formed. And these two leagues still compete for the right to send a team to the World Series. And so if you followed the World Series recently, you know, the Cubs won the pennant in their league, and the Indians won the pennant in their league, and then the two faced off in the World Series, of course. Baseball has been a spectator sport in American history for a very long time, as you can see. And it has also been an avenue for the civil rights movement. There are many famous African-American baseball players, Jackie Robinson being one of the more famous, but that comes later. And these athletes had to encounter discrimination. And they had to handle it in a public way because they were public figures. For example, African-Americans at this time were not allowed to play with white Americans. And so they formed their own league, because baseball was an American phenomenon. And in many ways, sports did bring us together, because it was a dominant form of spectator entertainment. Okay, so again, as I was saying, baseball became a public forum highlighting the issue of discrimination. And it would be many, you know, brave black baseball players who would advance the cause. But on to newspapers. More Americans were reading than ever before, 90% roughly by 1900. And that increased demand for newspapers. With cheaper paper, newspapers became more affordable. With increased standard of living, most Americans could afford to buy the newspaper. And of course, prior to social media, this is how Americans got their news at this time. And so newspapers were a big business. It's almost sad to say they were. They still are, but you know, the digital age is changing journalism dramatically. You know, where I still grew up reading the paper, you guys probably didn't. But as far as newspapers, just like media today, have to attract viewers. They are a business that requires your attention to make money. And so unless they draw you in, they don't make money. So think of clickbait. You all know what that is, right?
I don't know.
Okay. Really?
Oh, yeah, now I know what it is.
Okay, come on. I can't be the only one obsessed with social media. So clickbait is a form of journalism today that uses sensational headlines to draw you in. If you click on the link, that increases their ad revenue. All you have to do is click. And so they have to draw you in with something. You know, think of the tabloids, you know, Bat Baby Rescued by Jesus. Oh, okay, I'm sitting in line. Bat Baby Rescued Jesus? Huh? Okay, then I've picked it up. And maybe I'm like, hey, that's kind of crazy. I'm going to buy it. Well, you know, print journalism is on the way out. Digital journalism, again, still requires your attention. Still requires you to click on that link. Traffic. That's what media relies on. It relies on your attention. And so think before the digital age. What does a newspaper need to get you to buy it? You know, to get you not only to pick it up and read the headline, but then to be interested enough to read what's under the headline. Because to read what's under it, well, you're going to need to buy the newspaper. So, two of the most famous newspaper publishers at this time are Joseph Pulitzer of the Pulitzer Prize and William Randolph Hearst, who famously started, allegedly, the Spanish-American War to sell newspapers. They hyped it up, they hyped it up, they hyped it up.
they would notoriously exaggerate the news. It's a good thing that never happens anymore, right? Wink, wink. They would notoriously over-dramatize small events. Why? Because it gets us talking, it gets us watching, and it gets us reading. Yeah, I mean, I'm so over the election. I hate to say it, I just am. Because we are so inundated with, yeah, and I mean the election, and then I can't say it's going to be over, but we are so inundated with the media trying to sell us on the election. And so in many ways, the type of media that exaggerates the news, well, we see that every day. Moving on. The arts. Photography provided journalists and artists a chance to portray realism in a way that had never been possible before. Now, of course, photography had been around for some time, but the Kodak camera and the Kodak company offered an opportunity for the average American to engage in realism. So, in the arts as well, realism was becoming very popular. Artists like Thomas Eakins were famous for portraying life as it was. In fact, there was an entire school of art called the Ashkin School devoted to realism. Many of their artists would paint portrayals of life in the city as it really was. I've shown you some examples of that. Portray examples of working people. Abstract art was also introduced and becoming popular at this time. And just like today, many people find abstract art difficult to understand, but many do enjoy it as a form of expression.
Maybe we could say it was a funny drug reaction to the flu.
Who's got the story?
I don't even know if it's true.
What difference does it make if it's true? It's a story and it breaks, they're gonna have to run with it. How long we got till it breaks?
Front page, Washington Post tomorrow.
Oh, well, yeah, now that's not good. Okay. Just gotta distract them. Gotta listen 2 weeks till the election.
What in the world would do that? What in the world would do that?
Well, I'm working on it. The Gulf War, smart bomb falling down a chimney, 2,500 missions a day, 100 days. One video of one bomb, Mr. Moss. The American people bought that war. Mm-hmm. War is show business.
You want me to produce your war? Not a war, it's a pageant. We need a theme, a song, some visuals. We need, you know, it's a pageant.
It's a pageant.
It's a pageant, that's what it is.
Country's a war.
It's Miss America and your bird parks.
Why Albania?
Because.
Well, they have to have something we want.
Well, I'm sure they
do. What do we have that they want?
A little freedom.
Well, why would they want that?
Oppressed?
No. Fuck freedom. They wanna destroy the godless Satan of the United. They wanna destroy our way of life, all right?
Albanian terrorists have placed a suitcase bomb in Canada in an attempt to infiltrate the bomb into the USA.
Oh, that's good.
The president's gonna go to war with Albania in about 30 minutes.
You're declaring war in Albania?
No, we're not declaring war. We're going to war. We haven't declared war since the Second World War.
We're going to war.
The president of the United States has said that he apologizes for the need for secrecy, and he assures that it is necessary for the safety of the men and women in combat. He says that the Republic of Albania, long a staging ground for terrorism around the world, he is mentioning that a state of war is or is about to happen between the United States and the Republic of Albania.
Do you know who we are?
I'm afraid that's the trouble, Miss Ames.
CIA. Yeah, CIA.
Two things I know to be true. There's no difference between good flan and bad flan. And there is no war. We show, and NSA confirms, there are no nuclear devices on the Canadian border. There are no nuclear devices in Albania. Albania has no nuclear capacity. Our spy satellites show no secret terrorist training camps in the Albanian hinterland. The Border Patrol, the FBI, the RCMP report no untoward activity along our picturesque Canadian border. The Albanian government is screaming its defense. The world is listening. There is no war.
Of course there's a war. I'm watching it on television.
The spy satellites show it, Mr. Breen. They show no war.
Then what good are they?
If they show no war. I mean, what are we spending $250 billion a year on the Defense Department? What good are they if they show nothing? What, are they useless? Are they just broke or what? I mean, what is it? If there's no threat, then where are you? Let me go you one more. If there's no threat, what good are you?
Mr. Breen, you are the threat.
I'm the threat. I am the threat. Well, what have I been doing the last 30 years that you haven't been doing? You want to fill me in on that?
The last 30 years, Mr. Breen, I have been working to ensure the security of my country.
As have we all. And I would like to point out that the security of this country...
But if forced to choose between the security of your country and the security of your job, which would you pick? And while you hesitate, permit me to suggest that they are one and the same, your country and your job.
I'm doing my job, Mr. Breen. That's what you see me doing.
I'm doing my job.
What is it you are doing?
I'm doing my job, too. And let me ask you something. Let me ask you a simple question. Why do people go to war? Why do they go to war?
I'll play your silly game.
Okay, why do they go to war?
To ensure their way of life.
Would you go to war to do that?
I have.
And if you went to war again, who would it be against? Huh? Your ability to fight a two-ocean war against who? Who? Sweden and Togo? That time has passed. It's over. The war of the future is nuclear terrorism. It is, and it'll be against a small group of dissidents who, unbeknownst perhaps to their own governments, have blah, 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 blah. And to go to that war, you have to be prepared. You got to be alert. The public has got to be alert, because that is the war of the future. And if you're not gearing up to fight that war, then eventually the axe will fall, and you're going to be out in the street. And you could call this a drill. You could call this job security. You could call it anything you like. But I got one for you. You said go to war to preserve your way of life. Well, Chuck, this is your way of life. And if your spy satellites don't see nothing, if there ain't no war, then you can go home and prematurely take up golf, my friend. Because there ain't no war but ours.
Thank you. Thank you.
Drive carefully.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Nice enough people, they just haven't thought it through.
But as I said, the media, newspapers, journalists have often had the reputation of exaggerating the news. In fact, when we get to the Spanish-American War, I'm going to tell you about how William Randolph Hearst of the New York Herald sent a journalist to report on the condition of the Cuban Revolution, and he telegraphed back to his boss, and he said, there's really nothing going on in Cuba. It's not that exciting. Spain's got it under control, you know, it's just not really, and Hearst telegraphed back quickly, and he said, you furnish the pictures. Just take your pictures and shut up. I'll take care of the war. He said, send me some pictures, and I'll come up with headlines to get Americans riled up and start a war. And in fact, many could argue, and this is just one of the clear examples of where the media has really taken over. And so the new journalism here portrayed by this cartoonist is taking, taking us off the brink, if you will. But next, pop fiction. You know, before television, people read serial publications. You know, my wife and I, we do love some TV. You know, we watch some Netflix and some Hulu, and even from time to time when we can get HBO. But we like serials, meaning an ongoing story. You know, we're currently watching Homeland. It's about a guy who may or may not be a terrorist. Great show. Anyway, don't spoil it for me. I'm just pointing it out, saying it's a neat story. I'm four episodes in, I still don't know if dude's a terrorist. And I think that's a really cool way to tell a story. Well, serial fiction in the written form is also very popular. Of course, comic books are one portrayal of this. Pulp fiction. The term pulp fiction refers from the pulpwood of cheap paper that can be churned out in very, very cheap novels. And one of the most famous pulp fiction writers was Mark Twain. Samuel Langhorne Clemens, the comedian who used the pseudonym Mark Twain to write some of the most famous American novels. Of course, Tom Sawyer and Huck Finn, he's written a ton of them, and he's really funny. But he also points out a lot of, big problems in American life, like any good comedian would, right? You know, think of Louis C.K., think of The Daily Show. You know, those are both forms of political satire. while they're really funny and entertaining, even if that's not your thing, think of SNL. All of those three publications or comedians are forms of satire. And they all poke fun at the real world. And that's exactly what Mark Twain did in his time. And instead of high culture, you know, I'm sure you've read your share of literature, or you've taken classes on literature, or maybe you've read the Odyssey, maybe you've read some Shakespeare. You'll notice when you read Mark Twain, it's a lot simpler to read. You know, one day, one summer, I decided, I was like, okay, I'm going to be a history teacher. I need to struggle through and read the Iliad. And by gosh, I read the Iliad. And it felt like a summer reading assignment. And I was having to, like, hold the eyelids open as I was reading this book. And it was good for me, I guess. But it was one of those books I had to make myself read. But then when I was your age, I picked up Connecticut Yankee and King Arthur's Court. And it was funny. It was silly. It was entertaining. Because it's about a guy from the future going back to the castle times. And guess what he does? He builds a machine gun and kills everybody. And it's just great. And he's really funny about it.
That's awesome.
You know, and you have these, like, ridiculous scenes. And he's complaining about politics because, of course, they have some silly elections back then, too. And he said, hey, we should just elect cats and have this cat run versus this cat, etc. And then we can all just obsess about cats instead of presidents because they're kind of worthless anyway. And that was Mark Twain. Well, anyway, he just decided to make a career of it. And he was very famous in doing so. Of course, read Huck Finn. That's a great starter. Many were dime novels. Louis L'Amour, probably one of the more famous dime novelists of the West. But anyway, you got to read Huck Finn. It's just required reading to grow up in the United States. It's also just a really cool story about a kid who decides to take a boat, actually build a boat, and take it all the way down the Mississippi.
Slumming, I am. But of course, you'd rather work.
What do you call work?
Well, ain't that work?
Well, all I know is it suits Tom Sawyer.
Say, let me whitewash a little.
Think I'd let a dude whitewash?
Oh, come on now. I'd let you, if you was me.
No. If it were the inside, I wouldn't mind. And Aunt Polly wouldn't. But she's awful particular about the outside.
Aw, shucks. I'd be careful. I'll give you the rest of my apple.
Well, here, no. I'm afeard.
And I'll give you this, too.
Ain't that a humdinger? What is it?
It's a knob off a brass door knocker.
All my life I wanted a knob off a brass door knocker. Well, here. Quick, before I change my mind.
Shopping. Obviously, the way we have shopped has changed, but it can still be fun to go out to town and go to the mall. It can still be fun to go to a big shopping center. Well, if you're into shopping and going to the mall or having that shopping experience is something fun for you, the very first shopping center opened in 1890. It featured a glass top arcade with a piano player, so live entertainment as you shopped. And so this was meant to be a retail shopping experience. High-end luxury products catering to people willing to spend some hard cash. But then also, department stores. department stores became popular at this time as well, offering large quantities of reasonably priced goods. The very first department store opened in 1865, and this opened in Chicago. Now, the department store versus the retail store focuses on bargains. The idea of the bargain basement, that you can't beat our prices no matter what. We will match or beat any competitor. That's a department store concept versus a retail outlet. You know, if you go to Mass General Store on Main Street, you're not necessarily searching for the cheapest product. You're searching for some really cool stuff, maybe some nice clothes. You know, I'm always trying to find a hat that works for me. I just can't. I don't know why. I'm like hat disabled or something. But, you know, when I go to Mass General Store, I'm always like trying. I'm like, huh, yeah, okay, you know. And because they have a lot of nice products there. But now when I go to Walmart, I'm on a mission. I'm like, I need a bunch of stuff, really cheap, and I want out of here. There's the department store for you versus Mass General Store, which is meant to provide you more of an experience. Anyway. And maybe I even got ahead of myself. Mass General Store is a great example of a retail store. Whereas department store has mainly today been replaced by the chain store, because most department stores you'll go into are chains, you know, like Walmart, where you can go to any Walmart in the country and see the same basic format. That concept was developed by a man named F.W. Woolworth, and Woolworth's still exist today. There are some, not many left. But this man realized that he could offer, and we're all guilty of this, folks, poor quality products at reduced prices, and people would buy them because it's a bargain. And we are all guilty of this. You know we are. Yeah, we have all bought something that we know is not that great, because it's dirt cheap, you know, and I've just had to make myself learn over time it's better to have fewer nice things than lots of junk. But we're all still attracted by a big sale.
Yeah.
Now, Woolworth set up his chain store in a really neat way. Number one, he set up several of these stores as he became more successful, and he would set them up in the exact same way in every single store. So when you walk into a Woolworths anywhere, you automatically know where stuff is. But he also designed the aisles in a way that you would have to walk through every aisle to get to the register. Clever, right? Now, the old way of shopping, and if you watch any old movies, you can sometimes find this, is you would go up to the front counter and you would tell the clerk or hand them your shopping list, and they would go find everything for you. And you can still do that today. In fact, my wife went to pick up some things over the weekend. She did an online order on Walmart, and they had everything ready for her at the store, at the counter. And they do offer that service as a convenience. However, it is in these chain stores' best interest for you to just aimlessly wander around the aisles. And so they set them up that way. They also purposely limited service, limited personal service. And this was partly to save the money because they had to hire fewer people, but it was also to give you that experience of just wandering around and looking at stuff and realizing that you needed all of the stuff that you didn't actually need before. And then finally, advertising. Advertising exploded in the late 1800s and early 1900s. Just look alone by the budget, the amount spent per year on advertising, which really pales in comparison to today's world. But people began to see advertisements on billboards, in newspapers, sides of buildings. You know, some of the famous advertisements from these days included barns. In East Tennessee, where I'm from, Sea Rock City was a common big sign put all over barns. All right. Not all shopping was done in the store. Some of it could be done from home. The very first mail order catalogs called the Sears and Roebuck could be delivered to small towns all across the country. And so if you were this guy, you're not going to Woolworth, sorry. How are you going to get stuff if you're this guy in Kansas? Anybody? I mean, you could make your... Exactly. Okay, you're going to order stuff, right? And, prior to Amazon, you're going to order it from a catalog. And now I'm dating myself a bit, but I do remember ordering things from a catalog. Often you would have to wait 6-8 weeks was the usual standard, because it would have to be, your order would have to be mailed off and then returned to you. But it gave people access to the quantity of goods that you might expect from a department store, but from the convenience of your home. All right, so that's all I've got. So we're going to transition into group time. And then I believe we've got some presentations coming up. So if our first group would like to come up and start getting yourself ready. Meanwhile, continue working on your new group stuff.